So with that, our next sponsor presentation comes from the HPC Systems from LexisNexis, Charles Kaminsky.
I'm a senior architect at LexisNexis, and just a few days ago, John Holt called me, and he had to bow out because of some unexpected family medical issues. So our thoughts are with him, but I jumped at the chance to come down here and chat with you guys. And one of the first things I did was call Brian and ask him what types of things would the audience be interested in. He said, talk a little bit about HPCC, let them know what it is, give some examples of how we help businesses, and also give some examples of how we can help academia and other government entities. So hopefully that's what I'll do today as soon as we get those slides up and running. If I chatter just a bit, I'm just so surprised that if my teeth chatter, it's so cold here in California. A lot colder than I expected. So, like I said, I'm Charles Kaminsky. I'm a senior architect at LexisNexis, and also I'm a part of the HPCC Systems Group. And let's get started. So, I'm going to move this just so I can see as well. Oh, here it is. So, what is the HPCC platform? So, before we get to this slide, let me ask a show of hands. Who here works with data-intensive computing, big data? You have very large data sets. So a good number of folks. So high-performance computing can mean a number of things, but for us, it means big data, right? So what is the HPCC? It is, for us, a single platform and the supporting tools built specifically for data-intensive computing. And so what's so important to us about that is it is a single platform. We don't pre-process our data, and that single platform handles everything that we need to do from ingest all the way to data delivery. And that's very important to us because as an ECL engineer, and I'll get to that in just a second, I can sit in one place and solve the problems that come up, whether they be new algorithms that I need to develop or a product that I need to get out the door very quickly. So here's a little bit about the architecture, but we only have 15 minutes and we have a number of other things I want to chat about. But one of the things I do want to say is, as you do peruse this is, please do stop by. We're right next door. Our software is open source. And I believe that we probably have enough USBs for everyone here. We have a USB with our software, our source code, binaries, pre-compiled binaries, presentations, documentation, and like I said, there's at least one here for everyone in this room. So please do stop by, ask questions, and we'll give you a USB with the software on it. There's three main components. There is the Thor. And we call it a Thor because we think of a big hammer hammering away at the data. You can think of it very loosely, similar to Hadoop. It's not architected the same way, but it does solve similar problems. It is architected in a way that is built specifically for solving big data problems. And so it's not predicated on MapReduce. We can do MapReduce, so it's fairly trivial. To do it, but we believe that if you're using the MapReduce paradigm, as soon as you adopt MapReduce, boy, that's when the work really starts, converting those algorithms into MapReduce. And so the way we think about it internally is you have to take a problem that, a big data problem, and model it as a MapReduce problem so that you can solve it. And what we do with our platform is we take that big data problem and we model it as a big data problem. It solves a number of steps. And then a little bit later in the process, we don't have so many issues with trying to manage these MapReduce jobs and trying to communicate back and forth between large groups of engineers who are also managing these MapReduce jobs. And then we also don't have to bolt on a lot of other technologies to manage some of the issues that come out of it. The Roxy piece is our data delivery engine. The important thing to remember about that is it is not just key value. We can do key value only because, once again, to us, it's, that's a place to start. But it's it allows you to do complex queries, distributed indices, those types of things, fuzzy matching, fuzzy linking. The ECL language, that's the language that that we built specifically for data-intensive computing. And we've been working on it, improving it for more than 10 years. If anyone here is familiar with Borland, the old Borland C compiler guys, they're the folks who developed that language. They work for us. I can share a story with you. When I first started working on the platform about 2 years ago, one of the first jobs I was asked to do was uh, to to take a bloom filter and implement it on the platform. So I started looking at the source code. And I was immediately told, no, you've got the wrong idea if you think you need to dive into the platform to do this. This is a big data problem. I want you to model a bloom filter as a big data problem and write it in ECL. And so that's exactly what I did, and that kind of gives you an idea of it's not just a set of primitives specifically for certain data, big data challenges, but they are an expressive set of primitives for building new types of algorithms. We'll give you an example there as well. So really, I think I've borrowed this slide from some other presentations, and I've repurposed it here, but I think that what would be most interesting to the individuals here is the increased development speed, to get those solutions out the door very quickly, and that's part of the ECL language. Faster delivery with fewer resources. So those individuals, those decision makers here who are solving those big data challenges, they usually think about the teams that they have to work with to get the job done quickly. And you'll see in some of the examples I talk about in just a few moments, that's one of the places that we really excel. In terms of scalability, just a few factoids about our ability to scale and where we've scaled so far. And I think the most important piece here is those complex queries down at the bottom. You can see some of the numbers up there. And over time, those numbers will change, obviously, as we grow clusters and so forth. But the number at the bottom speaks to an architecture as opposed to a number of nodes. And you can see that query times, they stay fairly stable. And that also speaks to the SLAs, the service level agreements that we're required to keep with businesses we work with. The enterprise control language. This is just a little taste of what it looks like. And please do stop by our booth and ask us more questions. 15 minutes isn't enough to get into this. And I need to skip along to some of the business examples and some of the academic examples as well. But it just gives you a little taste for what the ECL language looks like. Just so you can get a nice visual. And of course, the most important piece, I think, is we're now open source. This had been a proprietary platform for a number of years, but now it's accessible and available to everyone in this room. And you can go to our website, download our source code, go onto GitHub and download our source code, that is. Go onto our website, download precompiled binaries and so forth. You can also see academic references, see folks who've written doctoral theses on our platform, published papers, those sorts of things. So that at least you can feel comfortable that that you can do academic quality work, publishable work on a platform such as this. So a couple of case studies. We'll start with some simple ones and then we'll move into some more complex ones. So this was a case study we did where we took a whole lot of traffic, network traffic, and analyzed it. Not a lot of linking, not a lot of other things. It's just, more along the lines of raw power and some analysis within the data itself. And you can see an outlier over there. What this is showing you is the ability to very quickly dive into that data and broaden the window. When we talk about analyzing network traffic, usually what we're looking at is windows that we can analyze in. If you don't have a whole lot of power, maybe you can only analyze a 5-minute window. And if the adversary on the other end of that traffic knows that your window is only 5 minutes, they can create a pattern that exceeds that 5-minute window, and you may not be able to find it. So what this allows you to do is to take that window and broaden it 15 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour, a week, so on and so forth, so that you can start seeing patterns within the data, and you can then identify possibly nefarious network traffic. Another example, this one speaks to some of the work that we've done internally. We recently acquired a company for about $4.1 billion, ChoicePoint. We took all of their, a significant portion of their internal platforms, thousands and thousands of databases, literally thousands of them, other systems, complex analytics that was done in these databases and these other systems, and migrated them all over to the high-performance computing platform. And we've done it quite successfully. And a significant portion of that $4.1 billion, that price tag was predicated on the ability to do exactly that. Here's another case study. It involves equity stripping. And what's really interesting here is to be able to identify the ringleaders. What Florida did for us is they gave us a little bit of information about some possible equity stripping that was happening in the state of Florida. And then what we could then do is take that information and find out who the influencers were to actually connect it to the individuals that were doing these sorts of things. So what it shows is the ability to take a whole lot of disparate data, bring it together, link it, fuse it together, and derive a solution very quickly that shows possible fraud that's occurring. I know I'm running through these very quickly, but I'm trying to touch on each one individually, hoping that there's one or two case studies in here that might spark your interest or might create a conversation later on. This one's insurance scoring. And what's really important to note here is insurance models are very complex. So we're talking about big data, we're talking about lots of data sources, and we're talking about complex mathematical models that allow them to score the data, to score these individuals. So what you can see here, what's very important, is that they were running processes that were taking about 100 days, 11.5 million reports. And we migrated that over. So as it states here in the slide, 75 different models, 74,000 lines of code. And what's really important, I think, to a large group of decision makers in the room is that it took us one man month to do that. And that's because of the efficiencies that we see within our system when we build big data solutions. That's what allows us to get those solutions out the door very quickly. And then, of course, on top of that is the ability to get all of that data processed very quickly. Running those 11.5 million reports only took about an hour within a development system, and we have it down to 30 minutes on a production system. Here's a visually pleasing case study. It talks about insurance collusion in the state of Louisiana. And what you can see here is known fraud that's occurring, right? But just because bits of fraud are occurring, it doesn't give you the big picture to know which individuals to go after or which individuals to investigate further. And it's really getting that big picture, knowing which big fish to go after, who may be 2 or 3 or 4 or 10 levels away from these transactions. That's really where the power of such a big data system comes in. And after we do all of that complex processing, we can see very easily two families that emerge where the vast majority of these transactions are occurring. These two families are linked in some way. So that's a piece on the business side. On the horizon, Brian mentioned that it might be interesting for you to know some of the things that we have that we're thinking about in the future. We just recently announced Amazon support, Amazon Web Services. An additional Amazon integration is coming. We have an Eclipse plugin for our IDE. We also have an IDE built specifically for our platform, but for those individuals who like Eclipse, additional support for the Mac is coming. And machine learning, which seems to be a hot topic right now in the world of big data and data-intensive computing, we have a machine learning library that we differentiate ourselves by showing that it is a single consistent library, that it runs across multiple nodes. There are some packages out there where you may be map reducing to access the package, but some of the algorithms are not running in a concert, so to speak, across multiple nodes. It's really just on individual nodes. And it's coded in a high-level data language, which is ECL again, which allows you to go in and inspect that code very easily. And so how we can help you, right? So the platform itself, whether you engage with us or not, you can go out and join the community. You don't have to engage us directly. If you just join the forums and participated, we still benefit. But we do enable complex data-intensive algorithms by taking a lot of that other work away, the work that is required to manage a cluster, convert complex algorithms into map-reduced steps, so on and so forth. It's one tool. You don't have to learn 20 or 30 different technologies, just one tool. And that, we hope, equates for faster solution development and faster time to publish. So how we particular, how HPC systems can help is we offer training for and other support in kind for certain projects. Classroom material and collaboration with the academic community. If you have a data intensive class or a high performance class. And then of course we also have student internships. Just stop by and grab a flyer. And that's it.